Hello, my name is Dr. Karen Lounsbury. I'm a professor of pharmacology at the University of Vermont Larner College of Medicine. And today we're going to be talking about the cannabis uses and its effects on the body and the brain. Just as a way of introduction, I'm also the course director for the medical cannabis course at the University of Vermont. And that course really covers medical cannabis all the way from the history through the development of the drugs, talking about the plant, the political implications, getting into receptors that are in your brain, and also its uses as potential pharmaceutical agent, the therapies. So through that course, I've had a lot of interaction and research on the aspects of medical cannabis. And what I'd like to share with you today is more of a general view of some of the aspects that we teach in that course to a more general audience. As I said, today we're going to be talking about the cannabis effects on the body and the brain. And my contact information is available here on the slide if you'd like to contact me for questions afterwards. I do need to put a disclaimer because of this particular topic. I am a member of the faculty at the University of Vermont, and my expertise comes from teaching the medical students and undergraduate students about the pharmacology of medical cannabis. And the materials presented here are going to represent my own findings and research and don't necessarily reflect the legal views or opinions of the University of Vermont. I am going to be presenting pharmaceutical agents according to their FDA approvals and clinical trials, and I have no financial interest to disclose. So the objectives that we're going to talk about today are, we're going to talk a little bit about the history. We'll describe the differences between the different types of cannabinoids that are found within the plant of cannabis. We'll talk about FDA approvals and clinical trials for the different cannabinoids. And then we'll talk about clinical data for other types of uses that aren't FDA approved. We'll talk about the abuse potential and the vulnerability of adolescent children. And then we'll talk about some special risks of cannabis and the use of cannabinoids in elderly patients. So the big question is cannabis a medicine or is it a drug of abuse? And we oftentimes see a very polarized view of cannabis as one or the other. And really the answer is it can be both. And it's very similar actually to our opioids, which have taken the opposite path. Opioids more being the medicine first, then becoming a drug of abuse, whereas cannabis more being a drug of abuse and then becoming a medicine. But they have a lot of the similar parallels. As a brief history of cannabis, really started out back in 10,000 BC, used for food and fiber, and then started to have medicinal uses and an herbal use long ago. And then in 1500, it was documented as the plant Cannabis sativa. And I will note that all strains of cannabis, you know, whether you've heard of sativa or if you've heard of indica, they all are the same plant, including hemp. They are the same species of plant. Now, in the 1930s, we had the Harrison Narcotics Tax Act, which made all marijuana products illegal. But then also at the same time period, as we moved into the 1960s and 70s, there was more scientific research done on the cannabis plant, and we isolated the compounds that we now know as THC and CBD. The drug Marinol, which is a synthetic THC, was approved in 1985, as I'll discuss a little bit later. And then the receptors for cannabinoids were discovered in the 90s. Since then, it's moved more towards compassionate use. And then we have many states that started making medical cannabis legal. If we look, this is the year that we started the medical cannabis course at UVM, 2015. And what we had were many states that had medical marijuana. If you look up here in New England, medical marijuana was legal back in 2015. If you look over California, Oregon, Nevada, and then we had Colorado, which was the only state that had also legalized what we now call adult use. At the time, it was considered recreational use. So it was fully illegal in 21 states in 2015. Now here's 2020. So if you take a minute to look at this map, all of the blue states have medical marijuana laws that allow the use of medical marijuana in some fashion. Now, what I will say, because this is state to state dependent, the different regulations related to how it's used medically can vary pretty greatly. What we have as far as fully legal with both adult use and medical use, we have, again, those same states that were early adopters for the medical use were also mostly the early adopters for adult use. And then we have a few states, Idaho, South Dakota, and Nebraska, who still do not have any medical use of marijuana. In 2018, Epidiolex, which is cannabidiol specifically, was approved for childhood epilepsy. And in 2019, it's only fully illegal in these three states. And all of them have laws that are under consideration for decriminalization, with the exception of Idaho. So that's the background of the legalization and kind of the historical change and the move towards having more medical use of cannabis and cannabis products. And now I'm going to get into a little bit of the nitty-gritty of the science behind the plant and the herbal medications versus what is an herbal medication versus a pharmaceutical product. So the plant Cannabis sativa produces a lot of compounds, and these are secreted in these little trichromes in both the flowers and the leaves, mostly in the flowers. And the different strains of cannabis produce different levels of biologically active components. So we have hemp, we have strains that are high more in cannabidiol, like Charlotte's Web. We have sativa and indica, and these are all strains, but they're all strains of the same exact plant. And it's thought that these cannabinoids, which are not made by any other plant unique to cannabis, that they might be either to protect the plant from drying out or to improve the sticking of pollen to the plant. So if we look even deeper at the cannabinoids that are produced by cannabis, there's over 100 compounds that are produced. And we have plenty of research to try and figure out what all of those cannabinoids do. The ones we know for sure have some biological activity are THC and cannabidiol. So THC is delta-9 tetrahydrocannabinol. And you can see why we always use THC rather than that. And the reason why this has biological activity is because it binds two cannabinoid receptors within cells. And there's a subset of the different types of cells that produce these receptors. There are many of these receptors in the brain, and it has psychoactive effects. This is also where it gets its anti-pain and anti-nausea effects, anti-spasm, and anti-immune effects through binding and activating the CB1 and CB2 receptors. Cannabidiol, which is the other primary biologically active component, actually is an antagonist, which means that it actually blocks a little bit of the effect of THC on those same receptors. So many times people think that they're the same, CBD and THC, that they're both cannabis, but they're very different. It's not psychoactive, so it doesn't get patients high, even at very high concentrations. But the thing that's interesting is it does have some of the same types of activities that THC has. It has anti-seizure activity, has anti-pain activity, anti-anxiety activity. And so it's really confusing why something that would maybe even block THC, why would it have any purpose in treating these disorders? We'll talk a little bit about that as we get to the individual effects of these compounds. The other thing is that these compounds have to be activated by oxidation, which usually occurs by heating the plant, which is why many times medical cannabis to be active, smoking, vaping, baking, heat extraction. Most of the compounds that are made in ointments or taken as a pill are heat extracted before they're produced. So the thing that's different about medical cannabis as a whole plant activity is that these cannabinoids, one, there's a lot of cannabinoids. So if you just take THC, you're missing out on a lot of stuff. The other point is that there are terpenes and terpenoids that are found within the plant There's over 500 of these compounds. And these compounds are also produced by many fruits. An example is the compound myrcene, which is produced by mangoes, limonene, which is produced by lemons and other citrus fruits. And what's thought is that these produce an entourage effect. They don't have biologic activity all by themselves, but when you combine them with the cannabinoids, they either affect the delivery of the cannabinoid or change its effect. It's known that some of these compounds allow the THC to stay in the brain longer, so you'll have a longer effect, for example. Okay, so that's the, kind of the compounds themselves. And we think of when taking medical cannabis, you're taking something from the outside. And I teach a lot of pharmacology, and I'm always trying to express to the students that when you add something from the outside, it's going to go everywhere unless you prevent it from going everywhere. So if you swallow a pill, it's going to go into your bloodstream and go everywhere. If you inhale something, it's going to go into your whole brain. And that's the receptors that are being affected are not selective. Your body, however, produces these same kind of compounds and is very selective at where it produces them. And that's what we call the endocannabinoid system. So when we talk about these receptors that are within these cells, they're expressed by a lot of different tissues. And the receptors expressed highest in the neurons, and the subtype of CB2 is expressed really highly in your immune cells. Both of those receptors signal to the neuron to shut off. They both types of receptors, when they're activated, when the receptor's activated, the neuron's turned off. Within the neurons themselves, they produce compounds that combine to those receptors. These are called endocannabinoids. So they're basically your own body's way of making THC and CBD. Really, most of the ones that we know of act like THC. We still have a lot of ways to go to learn what CBD is doing. So we have anandamide and 2-AG, which are just two examples of the actual compounds that are these endocannabinoids. And they only get secreted when there's hyperactivity in your neurons. So if you think about like a circuit, say you have a pain, you touch a hot stove, that neuron signal goes up to your brain. So if that's really heavily turned on by a really extreme pain, the endocannabinoid system gets activated and releases some endocannabinoids to sort of shut that down, turn down that pain a little bit. There's too much, and it's only turned on when there's a lot of activity. So if you think about it, it's like a feedback mechanism to limit the amount of activity. And the opioid system actually is somewhat similar to this. It's like a shutdown circuit breaker, kind of. So if you take a circuit breaker approach, it's very highly regulated. It's only in a certain area. It's only in those nerves. And now compare that with smoking a marijuana cigarette. You're going to affect those same areas and maybe reduce pain, but you're going to have a whole lot of other neurons that you're going to affect too. So really the goal is to try and improve the selectivity of effects of cannabinoids. Okay, here's showing what it kind of looks like in a graphical form, where you have, here's the cannabinoid receptor. It's actually part of the cell. So it's expressed right on the surface of the neuron. And then here's another neuron that's communicating. And neurons communicate by secreting what are called neurotransmitters. So these little neurotransmitters, in this case, it's glutamate. And when the neuron gets a signal, some of that glutamate gets released, binds to receptors on this, what we call postsynaptic receptor, and the signal carries on. So the glutamate signal is a positive plus signal, meaning if this was a pain circuit, keep the pain going, you know, take that message up to the brain. Now, if you have a really strong signal here, like excruciating pain, now you're actually activating this secondary glutamate receptor that causes the production of cannabinoids. Those cannabinoids are released and act on the receptor that's sending the signal. And if you remember, I said that these receptors turn it off. And that's how they do it. They turn off the ability of this receptor or this neuron to produce glutamate. So it's really just a feedback pathway. And now again, if you imagine, here's THC that you're taking into your body, the THC can bind to these same receptors and help turn off that signal. So that's really the biological basis for why cannabinoids can prevent pain. Okay, to get more to that, what do we have that we can use as a pharmaceutical agent that's going to act on those receptors to, and I keep using pain, but there are many other neuronal pathways that this can affect, but I'm going to use pain kind of as my general example. So dronabinol, which is the drug Marinol, is a synthetic THC. So it's the exact same compound. Every single bond is the same, but it's not made by the plant. Why is that different? Why does that make it different? It doesn't, except that it makes it legal. So the US FDA approved synthetic Delta 9 THC for nausea due to cancer chemotherapy in 1986. So this drug, THC, has been legal since 1986 as an FDA-approved drug. However, it's not legal when it comes from cannabis plant. It's also approved for HIV/AIDS-associated weight loss, and it's an FDA-approved Schedule 3 drug. However, the dronabinol itself, if it was a generic drug, is Schedule 1. So I know that sounds kind of confusing. What is Schedule 1 means it has no use as a medicine. This is reserved for things like cocaine, heroin. Schedule 3 means it has a medical use, but has a little bit of potential for addiction. So right now, the cannabis plant and everything within the cannabis plant is Schedule 1, illegal, and no medical use. The side effects of THC are pretty bad, mostly because of CNS, so central nervous system, related anxiety. And we'll talk about, if you recall back, I said a little bit about the entourage effect. THC all by itself is not a great drug because it causes anxiety in a lot of patients. So what are some cannabis extracts that are in development and clinical trials that could potentially become FDA approved? We have several that are in phase 3 clinical trials. And what you'll notice is that they all have both THC and cannabidiol together. So there's a 1-to-1 THC CBD sublingual spray that's been approved for epilepsy. Actually, the CBD alone is approved for epilepsy, but is in clinical trials for motor disorders, spasticity disorders, and epilepsy. And the CBD alone oral solution is approved for childhood seizures, and it's in clinical trials for anxiety disorders and for treatment of autism, not with respect to treating the autism itself, but to help patients that have autism to have reduced anxiety. So how do these different cannabis strains and formulations, what is the difference? I mean, we see a lot of things that are coming out from dispensaries that are in different formulations. So I just want to spend a couple minutes talking about what those different things are, how they should be taken, and are why are they different from each other? So first we have cannabis sativa as the whole plant, which is either smoked or vaped. And by vaping, it's just raising the temperature so that the cannabinoid can be vaporized. So hemp has a very low concentration of THC, a very high concentration of CBD. So THC is your active ingredient that's reducing pain. CBD seems to moderate the effects of THC in a way that it reduces side effects, but maintains the the medical use that you want. So almost everything is going to have a combination of THC and CBD that's used medically. Indica is simply a different strain that has sort of medium levels of THC and medium levels of CBD. And then sativa, very high levels of THC and lower levels of CBD. So THC really has the most psychoactive effects with respect to potential for causing hallucinations, changes in how perceptions occur. And then there's a lot of hybrids as well. When we talk about oils, these can be delivered either under the tongue or sublingual or given orally. And the advantage to giving it under the tongue is that it gets absorbed into the bloodstream more quickly and delivered for its medical use than if you take it orally. If you swallow it, it has to get metabolized, absorbed across the stomach, gets into the bloodstream, goes through the liver, gets somewhat metabolized in the liver, then gets there. So it takes a lot longer and may not have as much of an effect because some of it gets metabolized and inactivated before it even gets to its target. So oils have an effectiveness there. One thing I will also note is that because the cannabinoids are very lipophilic, that means they're very oily, they have the ability to cross through membranes really easily, and they also have the ability to get into the brain really easily, which is why you can use a sublingual formulation for them. There are some tinctures, they call them. So what's a tincture is really just a sublingual formulation. And for most conditions, a 20-to-1 THC to CBD has been effective. So here you only just have a small amount of CBD to prevent some of the anxiety side effects. And a 1-to-1 combination for seizure disorder because CBD all by itself is effective for seizure. And then last I would talk about a patch formulation, which is where you put it on the outside of your skin and it's there with an adjuvant that helps it to cross across the epithelial membrane. So as you know, your skin is pretty tough. Your cells with inside your body, things can pass through them pretty easy, but it's pretty hard to get things across your skin. But again, the cannabinoids are really lipophilic. They have the ability to pass through membranes pretty easily. So they work with these transdermal patch formulations. And then we have the edibles, which are cookies and brownies, much slower, and actually a higher likelihood of causing some trouble with patients because it takes so long for the effect that sometimes patients will eat too many and then regret it later because they end up with a too high of a concentration of THC and they feel really ill. You know, most patients are not looking to get high from these. They're looking for relief of pain or spasticity. So it's not a desired effect to have the high anxiety that they might have if they have too much in their system. And then the least effective is the ointment. Because in the patch formulation, they have it especially with an adjuvant to help it cross the membrane. An ointment is a very localized effect and would only really be affecting the cells that are right in, say, if you put it on your knee for pain, you would only be affecting that area. So it's very localized, but also a little bit less effective. Okay, here is the first engagement quiz for you. Hopefully you are all paying attention and I'm going to give you just, it says 2 minutes, but I'm only going to give you a minute because you're not discussing it with each other. So think about it. I'll give you a minute and then we'll see how you did. Okay, you've got 15 seconds. All right, on the count of three, everybody yell out your answer right into your screen. 1, 2, 3.
A?
A.
All right. Nice work. So the cannabinoids are very lipophilic, so they can cross membranes easy. And that's important both for how they're delivered, and it's also important for how fast it gets into the brain, because the lipophilic molecules are able to pass up through into the brain much more easily. Okay, let's move on to the next piece. We have, we're looking at the pain pathways and the cannabinoid receptors. They have a very high density of receptors in your central nervous system, also high density in sensory neurons. So these are the ones I was describing with pain, those neurons, and also in the autonomic nervous system, which is the response that your body has to the pain. So when you feel ill and sweaty, your blood pressure goes up, your heart rate goes up. That's your autonomic nervous system responding to the pain. And so we want to reduce the sensory, and we also want to reduce your perception of the pain. And the cannabinoid type 2 receptors are more in your immune cells. They also are found in sensory neurons. And we think that the role of CB2 is mostly through those immune cells. All right, so let's look at cannabis as medicine. We know that there's proven effectiveness of THC in several areas: pain, chemotherapy-induced nausea, seizures, spasticity, and this disorder called cachexia, which is a wasting disorder, losing lots of weight. We see that mostly with HIV. It's likely effective, meaning we have some trials that show that it looks pretty good for the treatment of eating disorders, glaucoma, and anxiety disorders. And then possibly effective where it may have an effect, but we really need more research. And these are the ones where you have to be really careful to not say THC, prevents substance use disorder, or THC treats Parkinson's, because it does seem to have some effectiveness, but we can't really say right now that it does. And especially with cancer, I want to point out that there are some actual basic research science undergoing the use of cannabinoids to reduce the growth of cancer cells. So actually being a treatment for the progression of cancer, not just the side effects for cancer. However, these are so early on that if the danger is somebody will say, well, I have this cancer, but I'm not going to use the chemotherapy that gives me side effects because I think that the THC will do the job. And that's really dangerous, because if a patient does that, they're at risk. Okay, so I'm gonna fairly quickly go through the treatment in pain, because we've given a fair amount to this topic already. But I do want to show you how it compares to an opioid. So in the case of opioids, you have an endogenous opioid system, or you can add opioids from the outside. Say somebody uses morphine, for example. And when it binds to those receptors, the opioid inhibits the pain signal. So the opioids are released in these different areas within the circuits that are leading from the pain source up to your brain and then back down. And so the opioids bind to receptors and slow down or turn off the pain signaling pathway. The thing with opioids is that they exhibit a lot of tolerance, meaning that if you give an opioid to a patient, you will need to use more and more dose if you maintain the patient on those opioids. And opioids are the best agent that we have to control pain, other than general anesthesia, which obviously is not something you can use. And I'll say right off the bat that THC doesn't even come close to the efficacy of things like morphine. Not as potent, not as useful. However, the problems with opioids lead us to really look for other agents that can be used for the treatment of pain and other things that you're using opioids for. For example, we now know this drug fentanyl, which is laced within some heroin. If patients that have substance use disorder think that they're delivering heroin and they're delivering fentanyl, This is showing the toxic dose of fentanyl compared with the toxic dose of heroin. And so you really need such a small amount. And fentanyl is actually a useful medication for the treatment of pain, but you use so, so little that it's very easy for patients to overdose. We use antagonists to treat opioid overdose, and we use a partial agonist to treat addiction. And some of these activities, looking at cannabinoids for reducing the amount of opioid you'd have to use or helping with the treatment of addiction. Okay, so endocannabinoids and cannabis reduce the pain signal in the interpretation of pain. Very similar there. Cannabinoids are not as effective. They do produce less tolerance, less risk of addiction, less risk of overdose. So they have a place in the treatment of pain. They won't replace opioids, but they have a place in the treatment of pain. And the reason why they have the low toxicity compared to opioids is because of where those receptors are. If you remember, I was talking about the CB1 receptors in the brain. Those receptors, unlike opioid receptors, aren't expressed in the areas of the brain that control your breathing. So the opioid receptors, if you have too much opioid, you suppress your breathing, you stop breathing, and that causes death. Cannabinoid receptors just aren't there. Opioids and ethanol both depress the activity in that lower brainstem, and so breathing slows even when you're running out of oxygen. So if you overdose on either opioid or alcohol, your breathing will slow down no matter what. They're very difficult to treat as well, because you can't increase the breathing of the patient. You just have to substitute by breathing for them. Opioids and ethanol also increase vomiting risk, and many deaths from overdose are actually due to aspiration of vomit rather than stopping of breathing, and cannabinoids don't cause that. Well, here's your next quiz. So thinking about the things that we just talked about, I want you to take just a minute to think this through and have your answer, and then we will see how you're doing. Okay, 15 more seconds. Have your answer ready. Okay, on the count of three. One, two, three.
C.
C.
Okay, this was a harder question.
Yeah.
This was a harder question. So if you hadn't been listening very carefully, really the key thing is that there aren't receptors in the area of the brain that controls respiration. Mm-hmm. Others, you know, would be reasonable answers. But cannabis overdose does not cause respiratory suppression. There are problems with cannabis overdose, but mostly related to high anxiety. Somebody, it's as if they are having a hallucination. Some patients, when they overdose, will think that time has stopped. And that's a very, very scary thing to imagine. And so there are side effects to an overdose, but respiratory suppression and death is not one of them. Just want to take a moment to talk about, are these really effective? This is actually a pain intensity scale, and this is in the elderly population, because the worry always is there a difference between populations? And what they did was a pain intensity scale for patients. And so what we're looking for is before treatment are these darker blue, and then after 6 months after treatment are the lighter blue. And so what we found is that those who had really high pain intensity scores before the treatment, so this is these out here, after treatment with cannabis, it really did reduce the amount of pain scale that they had. And so is it really stopping the pain, or is it stopping their perception of pain? And honestly, we don't know, but does it matter? It doesn't matter, because how a patient feels is what we're really looking for. And so even if, and this is beyond a placebo effect, which we do have a lot of placebo effect with anti-pain medications. So those patients that had the highest pain seem to be those that really benefited from the treatment. Okay, so we've talked about cannabinoids enhancing pain control, and partly because there's a different receptor mechanism than the opioids, so you could use them together. Reducing the opioid side effects, so nausea and constipation that occur from use, long-term use of opioids. If you add in cannabinoid, you can reduce the amount of opioid so that you have reduced amount of side effects. And because of the additive pain relief, you're really reducing the overall amount of opioid that you need. There's also reduced risk of dependence, because withdrawal from opioids can be very uncomfortable, and using a cannabinoid can replace some of, prevent some of that withdrawal. Okay, so we only have a few minutes left, but I do want to talk a little bit about nausea, because it seems to most people think of nausea and feelings in your stomach as being completely separate from pain, but they're very closely linked, and they're both controlled by nerves and neurons. And this is a very complicated circuit that I show when I'm teaching my students about this. So it's a little bit beyond what would be expected for the general population, but your stomach communicates to your brain, and part of your brain has this vomiting center. Also, your inner ear connects here, which is why when you get motion sick, you feel nauseous. So these are all connected by neuronal pathways. And this vomiting center is regulated by several different receptor subtypes, but I'm just going to point out that cannabinoid receptors in your gastrointestinal tract itself will prevent the signal of something irritating your stomach causing the vomiting center to get activated. Really important for chemotherapy-induced nausea. The second is this area that signals to the vomiting center also has cannabinoid receptors that reduce the signals coming from your inner ear or from your brain. So it has a direct neuronal link to preventing nausea. And so in cancer care, we have cannabinoids having an effect, and also making sure that it's not just THC, that you might need to add some CBD or have whole plant cannabis that could have improvements in cancer care. Inhalation of whole plant cannabis does give faster relief, and the metabolism profile is different. So cannabis as a whole plant definitely has a place. And as we learn more about which compounds make it most effective and have the least amount of side effects, we may not need whole plant cannabis as an option, but right now it does have some advantages. Disadvantages: it's illegal in some states still. Patients are very hesitant to use it. We don't have a lot of clinical trials with whole plant cannabis. Almost all of the clinical trials I talked about, that's with THC and CBD. And it's really difficult to standardize. Murray said there's lots of strains. We don't know what's in it, and that's always a worry. Mm-hmm. So to give sort of an overall summary of the difference between THC and CBD with its effect, we have no effect of CBD on the reward pathway. So this is going to give you, is it have potential for addiction? We do have effects of CBD in muscle spasm, in pain, and in potential for reducing anxiety and actually counteracting THC. And the effectiveness of CBD has not been clinically proven, though, except in seizure disorder, as far as being FDA approved. But it does, combining it with THC does definitely seems to improve its activity. Okay. spend just a couple of minutes talking about the potential harms for the use of cannabis and the use of cannabis products. And the harm of using it more often and more frequently and having it more available, making it legal, there is an increased accidental ingestion. And we have not had deaths because of the accidental ingestion. However, high anxiety and patients come to the emergency room frequently. The biggest problem is with the edibles, which I described earlier. Cannabis intoxication, big public health risk. And really, it's about impaired driving. So there's no doubt that cannabis causes impairment in driving, and it's still difficult to do field testing for the effects of cannabis and anxiety attacks with overdose. The final and probably most important really is cannabis addiction disorder because of the adolescent vulnerability to this. And we talk about cannabis addiction. It's attributed to THC action in the brain. And the head rush and euphoria that results does affect the reward pathway, which can lead to addiction. The appetite increase is due to effects in the hypothalamus, and the decreased attention and sedation are because of the hippocampus. And again, I'm just kind of flowing through these brain areas just to show that the individual neurons that these cannabinoids are affecting are systems in your brain that have broader effects. And then you have your altered perceptions with the prefrontal cortex inhibition. And I'm going to focus on that aspect a little bit because that's what really separates THC from other sedating drugs, is that it doesn't just sedate the brain, which it does do have some sedating effects, but it changes perceptions. And those perceptions are due to the area of the brain called the frontal cortex. And this responds to new experiences. It's a really important part of your brain. So if somebody has a new task, they hear a new sound or they have to do a new thing, you can see all these areas of the brain light up, and particularly part of the frontal cortex. Whereas if you do it unconscious, like you're driving to work for the 999th time, you're not really turning on your frontal cortex unless a dog jumps out in front of you, and then your prefrontal cortex will light up again. So things that can reduce the activity of the frontal cortex include meditation, intense exercise, daydreaming. These all are considered positive things that can help us to relax ourselves. And that's one of the reasons why cannabis is used by patients or the general public in adult use to kind of relax them and bring them away from the day's activities. Some drugs of abuse, such as cannabis and opioids, reduce the activity of the frontal cortex, but they also have effects on the reward pathway. When we talk about perception, we're talking about a combination of your sensory input and your frontal cortex being able to tell what the perception is. So I use this just as an example. This is a group of people who are looking at, walking down a path and everything looks okay. And our perception is this is just something kind of regular. But if it looked like that, immediately your frontal cortex says, whoa, something's not right there. So that's kind of what I mean by your ability to distinguish errors in your environment using your frontal cortex. So if something's not right, that's when your frontal cortex is activated. And that's how you can see how if you're reducing that effect through cannabis, it's going to impair your driving. I do want to do one more thing that's active with the audience, and that is a Stroop test, which will again point out what happens if you reduce your frontal cortex activity. And for those of you who may have color blindness, this is a bit of a difficult test, and I apologize for that, but it's really the only way in which I can produce this right now. So the first task is to identify the color of these words. So So just take 10 seconds to kind of run down them and identify the color of the words in your mind. Okay, so that was pretty easy. Now, if someone is under the influence of cannabis, this next task will be very hard. So now, again, I want you to identify the color of the words. Identify the color of the words. It's a lot harder. It's a lot harder because you're distracted by the word in identifying the color. And in someone who is under the influence of cannabis, that's even harder because their frontal cortex is suppressed and they're not able to separate out the distraction. And that's kind of what I mean by causing impairment, but also being a benefit from a meditation aspect. It has pluses and minuses. Okay. So the effects on attention, your peripheral attention is reduced. Memory can be affected, and color and image perception. So it does have an impaired ability to drive. Motor coordination is not as impaired as alcohol, not even close. So the field tests of sobriety for alcohol involve motor coordination, and somebody could potentially pass a motor coordination test under the influence of THC. So that's not useful. And states that have legalized recreational use have seen an increase in car accidents, but there isn't a difference in fatal car accidents. So it's still kind of debatable what the effects on impairment is. With respect to addiction potential, cannabis is around 9%. However, the percent of the population who uses cannabis is much higher than some of these other compounds. Like heroin, for example, your risk is 23% of becoming addicted. However, 9% of a much larger population is almost as many people. So we do have to keep that in consideration. It is a lower risk. However, more people are apt to have a substance use disorder. And if we look at the danger graph, this is physical harm versus the dependence. You can see heroin's way up here in the corner, lots of physical harm, lots of dependence. And marijuana is relatively low physical harm, but is still cause some dependence. Alcohol has more physical harm, sort of puts it in perspective. Tobacco, alcohol, and marijuana being the three most common social drugs. And young people are particularly vulnerable to dependence because when an addicting drug is started before the age of 18, there's a much higher risk for them developing a substance use disorder. And it's thought that because that frontal cortex is still developing in the adolescent population, that they're much more likely to be susceptible to that. There's also a disorder called amotivational disorder with chronic use. And that also is much more likely to occur in younger patients. So as a final summary, I just want to kind of recap that we talked about the biological effects of cannabinoids and the different components of cannabis, especially THC and CBD. We talked about some of the therapeutic effects and why it has effects in pain and anxiety, and also we talked a little bit about the potential harms of cannabis in that it can cause distracted driving and it affects the adolescent population with vulnerabilities to addiction. And just as a final, I want to point out that we do have more information about the therapeutics and use of cannabis for specific medical conditions through modules and programs at the University of Vermont in cannabis science and medicine. Some of these programs are free. There are some more specific webinar type items, and there's also a certificate that that can be part of registration. So I welcome you to do that, and thank you for listening, and I welcome any questions.
In another life, I worked with the Department of Labor and working with people who lost jobs through no fault of their own. And this one fellow came in and he was a highly skilled machinist, and he had an accident. And it really messed up his back to the point where, you know, he said, having a little cannabis at night, he said, if I could just get a good night's sleep, that's all I need. I didn't need to do anything during the day. I didn't need to do it. But if I got to sleep at night, I could work. And so the company he worked for was okay with it. It was a Vermont company. The company left the state, and now he's got to find a job. And this was just before our laws were passed. But even with our laws, if he was working for a company that did drug testing, and this stays in his system for so long, and you know, even when he would, and he would be upfront when he was applying for the job, whatever the job was, that, you know, this is what I need, this is what I do, this is how responsible I am. And they'd say, well, you know, we can't change our policy for one person. And so, I mean, hearing all of this and then having that, those kinds of situations, and having it being for medical use being okay in most states now, like, how does, have you heard of industry changes around their policies?
That's a really good question. And the, no matter what the federal government, and this holds true for some other medications too, businesses will still have the ability to restrict medications, do drug testing. They can do it for alcohol. They can do it for, I think even some can do it for tobacco. And and it's not going to change completely if it gets rescheduled. But I think that there will be a lot more companies who will accommodate it.
Yes.
If they do. And yeah. I think it sounds like this person is doing exactly the right thing. You know, being upfront about it, telling them that this is why I need to use it, this is how I use it. And if it is descheduled and a physician can actually prescribe it, or at least give him some sort of documentation that he needs this,
yeah,
change things. So there are still always going to be some instances where you might, like a school bus driver, for example, or a truck driver, you know, anybody who's driving on the road, that it doesn't matter if you have back pain, you're not going to be able to use cannabis.
Right. Thanks.
Yeah, my question was about, you know, CBD, at least in the last year or so, maybe last 2 years, just really became a thing, almost to the point of being a parody and a joke about Vermont, you know, or what about people's perceptions of Vermont. Were you surprised at the level to which it gained the popularity that it did culturally?
I think CBD, because it doesn't have the psychoactive effects and was more acceptable and did get approved by FDA, has been something that people have grabbed onto. I think I wasn't surprised at all, because there are so many people who are struggling with pain. Is the primary pain is the primary reason why people use medical cannabis. And if you can find something that's going to relieve your pain that isn't relieved by prescriptions, or maybe it's relieved, but then you're all foggy headed, like many patients who take opioids, it didn't surprise me at all that it was super popular. The big worry is that because it's not regulated at all, you have no idea how much CBD is in any product that you get, unless you go to the dispensary. But to go to the dispensary, you need to have a card for medical cannabis card. So it's like pluses and minuses for if it becomes descheduled, because if it becomes descheduled, then patients can talk to their physicians about it. They can't even talk to their physicians about it now. And also we can have some regulated products that are, you know, we know what's in them. So that if you want to take CBD, if it is working for you, you want to make sure you have a reliable source to use it. So.
Yeah, I think that's a reflection I have. I think what I've heard from people saying, I think more with the THC cannabis is like with a beer, yeah, it'll say 7.2% alcohol or whatever, you know, heady toppers, a double IPA, lots of alcohol. I know if I'm going to have one of those, it just has to be one or you know, I certainly shouldn't drive and I might fall asleep. But with THC, you know, if it's, you know, a product, you might not know what that experience is going to be because you might not know the potency of it. Maybe with edibles, but especially if people are smoking marijuana cigarettes, it's really kind of a crapshoot. And it seems like the potency has really increased over the decades, where the difference between having an enjoyable experience and having something that's, like you said, brings on lots of anxiety can be very razor thin.
Yes, definitely. And there's always the pluses and minuses. Like, you don't want to remove the ability to have some kind of integrative health, you know, where people are using it as herbal medications, because the whole concept of your own body and taking care of your own body rather than just taking a pill, medical cannabis has that way of making people have a little bit more of a global feel about what they're putting into their bodies. And so you don't want to remove that completely, but at the same time, you don't want to have a sort of snake oil thing where they're getting products that don't even have any THC or CBD in them and being sold as these medicinal products.
There's such a thing as like the perception of our perceptions, like the before we, like, this is actually like all with respect to adolescence. So before we even like, we all have some sort of, I guess, I don't know if that's like our executive functions, but we all have like some sort of idea of whatever we might experience, right? Before we actually use any THC. So I'm wondering if, like, for an adolescent who's, you know, if they use it for a long time, does that alter their perceptions, like their natural perceptions, like in the future, like with respect to like them experiencing all of these like first time experiences like simultaneously? Do you know what I'm saying? And then like as they get older, will it be hard to kind of undo that?
I think I know what you're trying to say, that is there a, because they're affecting their perceptions at an early age, is it going to prevent them from being able to take in new experiences the same way in the future? And there's a lot about child psychology related to THC that we don't know that much about, but what we can see is that it's known that at adolescence, when kids are starting to challenge things, they're starting to try and figure out where they fit in the world, and that's where their executive functions are, they seem the worst because they're immature and they're rebellious, and those types of behaviors are because their frontal cortex is sort of trying to figure things out. It's like, and testing it, challenging it is the way that the process of growing up and maturing happens. So if you suppress that with THC and chronic, and this is really was mainly done, these studies were done with chronic use between the age of 14 and 16 seemed to be the most critical area, that if they had chronic heavy use, there was a risk for not only substance use disorder, but also for having the inability to be motivated in ways that normal adolescents would. And I think that's getting at what you were talking about, where it changes your whole ability to take in new perceptions and put them into perspective and learn from them and want to have them. And there's, like I said, there's still a lot we need to learn about it, but protecting that population from heavy use of cannabis is a really important public health prospect.
How did you first get involved in this study, this research, right? What sort of captivated you about the topic and about these drugs?
Well, that's a very interesting question, because it came out, I'm in the College of Medicine, and at the time when we started developing this course, we were trying to think of courses that would be attractive to the undergraduates. And it wasn't that we came up with the idea, oh, talk about pot, you know, because everybody's interested in pot. It was more, we want to take a single drug and take it from beginning to end. And cannabis was the perfect choice for that, because it has the politics, it has the history, it has the plant. It's a medicinal plant, yet it has these compounds. And now we have an FDA approved drug. And it just seemed like we could cover so much about one drug. And the course keeps evolving, because the politics and the drugs and the clinical trials, they all keep changing. So I showed you that map from 2015 to 2020, but the whole course has changed over time as research is done. And it'll be interesting. I think that within the next 4 years, we will have a change in schedule, because I think if every single state has it medically legal, I think that's kind of a pretty good indication that the country would promote it being Schedule II, which Schedule II is like your highest potency opioid. So it's not like you're saying, oh, let's just give it out like aspirin, you know, it would still be controlled. It just would be legal, because right now it's not. So my interest was, we developed this idea around the course. And then once we got into it, I have co-directors as well. There's two other people who work on the course with me. We all just, it was really fascinating. The receptors, I focus on the receptors and the signaling, as you could probably tell from the things I focused on in my talk, but others were more interested in the plant biology, you know, what other compounds are in there. And the other course director is, he's more interested in the organic molecules. Can you make synthetic molecules that would be similar to these cannabinoids that might be better or worse for use as medical cannabis?
So, you know, I saw on your list, you know, that there's, it's good for this, it's good for this, and the jury's still out, but maybe. I was thinking of one was Parkinson's and something else. And so I'm thinking about, like, somebody with Parkinson's who's getting treatment. You know, I know that there's a lot of, I mean, that's such a, Parkinson's seems to be a moving target. You know, not everybody responds the same way. Not everybody, you know, like, some people are doing movement therapy and it's the most amazing thing ever. And some people, you know, are responding to their drugs. So, I mean, what's the harm of adding this to their repertoire of help and relief?
Yeah, that's a good point. You're right. Personalized medicine, I think, is, and patients taking more control of their treatments is good for a number of reasons. That whole thing I was talking about, you know, nobody's necessarily controlling what you do with your health. You have control over your health. And the more control you feel, the more effective your treatments are going to be. Because it's not just, you know, the receptor binding to the molecule. It's a lot more than that. And so a patient that has Parkinson's, if they wanted to try it, there is really very little potential harm in it. As mm-hmm. long as they are having some kind of guidance around it. An elderly population, which most patients with Parkinson's are elderly people, there's not been a lot of problems with drug interactions with any of the drugs that are used for Parkinson's. Mm-hmm. And So it would be reasonable to try it as part of a regimen if a patient wants to give it a try.
Are you seeing a correlation between the legalization of cannabis like nationwide to the like the amount of education people are getting about it? Like before there wasn't, you know, like if it wasn't legalized, it was all more like really hidden and hush hush. Like, is there more information available now because of it?
Oh, definitely. I one of the lectures I teach during the course is about the societal impacts, and I talk about early adopters versus late adopters. My comparison is with like cell phones. You know, early adopters wouldn't get an iPhone, and then the general population started using iPhones, and now most people, not necessarily an iPhone, but a smartphone, I guess you should say. It's not just not making an advertisement for iPhones, but the same thing is happening with understanding and appreciation for medical cannabis, because there was a small, it starts with a little grassroots type activity, and the people who are the late adopters are like, oh, those people are crazy. But then as more and more information comes out and more acceptance, then you have the general population that not only accepts it, but embraces it and might try it. And then the late adopters who will still maybe be questioning, and then only once it is fully recognized and prescribed by their physician might they consider it. And so as time has moved by, that shift of that curve is shifting and shifting and shifting. And I think now the general population at least accepts that medical cannabis has some uses.
I wonder how long culturally will it take to get past certain associations of it with the 60s and Grateful Dead, or, you know, there's some other associations that people would bring to marijuana.
Yeah, I always think of it as, you know, what better thing to keep kids from using it than making it a medicine for older folks?